We're very excited, new this year, so we spend a lot of time talking about growers and who are our customers for all of these interesting technology innovations that were coming up. And we felt that it was important to bring some of those people who are adapting technologies in their own operations to talk with us and to answer questions that we have about what is the future of adaptation, of what are your pain points, what are you looking to solve in your operations. So I'm grateful to Brad Uken, who's here from the Champaign County Farm Bureau, and will moderate this panel, and will introduce our esteemed growers who have come from around the region. So thank you, Brad, and take it away.
Well, thanks for having me here today. And it's more important than thanks to having the panel. So we'll start off with the extreme basics here, guys. Why don't you tell us a little bit about your farming operation, where you're located at, the family that may be part of it. And Pete, why don't you start with
it? My name is Pete Pistorius. I'm a farmer around central Illinois, so just south of Decatur, actually, so 40 miles southwest of here. Farm with my father and my brother-in-law on a sixth-generation family farm. Raise corn and soybeans. In addition to row crops, we have a commercial grain elevator and a small seed business as well.
Matt Barnard, farm with my family, my father and my brother in central Illinois. Home base is Chenoa, and farm around five counties in that area. Went to school here at the University of Illinois, didn't have the chance to come back to the farm right away. Our farm was not large enough, and so spent about 15 years in the seed and chemical business before the farm got to the size where it warranted my return. I like Pete, involved still in the seed and industry, and we do a lot of stuff with drones as well.
Ken Dahlenberg, and I live about 12 miles west of town here, and we farm in Champaign and Piatt County, corn and soybeans, and also a graduate from the U of I here. Been involved in this whole technology business since the early 90s, and have done a lot of testing and working with different companies in helping them improve products. And this whole technology has changed a lot over the last 25 years.
So Ken, let's build on that before we kind of move into each of your individual operations. Let's talk a little bit about how's technology changed agriculture, and this is broader than just your farm. Give your perspective of how it's changed in agriculture, say, in the last 3 years, in the last 12 months.
Well, really, there's been about four paradigms in agriculture that have happened in the last couple of years. One is the change in telematics. The second, the iPhone has made communications and data much easier. The third is the iPad, and the fourth is just data in itself. And I think those are areas that everybody in this room is looking at and has helped change agriculture to improve our business operations, but also improve our agronomy.
When I was growing up on the farm, we often talked about fields, and now we talk about zones. And here pretty quick, we're starting to talk about specific acres. So in an 80-acre field now, I don't think of it as 80 acres. I might think of it as 81-acre tracts, or maybe even smaller, when you start to think about some of the opportunities that are there. So everything with that, being able to collect that information, and like some of the other panelists talked about, how after we've collected that information, what we do with it, we're very much a price taker in this industry, and we develop a plan that we ultimately rely on Mother Nature to help us execute. And if whether we can have an awesome plan right now, and we know that it's gonna change by the time we go to harvest. And so having the ability to do something about that is really changed in the last 10 years, but in the last 2 to 3 years, now we have so much information, we've got to decipher what we can actually handle, but then also actually implement.
I guess whenever I think about it, I think about it maybe stretching back a little bit farther. And I started farming in 1997. And I think it was about then that we bought our first yield monitor. And, you know, it seems like through the first 20 years from 97 on, that all we did is collect data. And so, I don't know about you guys, but in our office, we have shelves full of three-ring binders that have yield maps in them and soil tests and all this stuff. And all we did for 20 years is it felt like that we were just collecting more and more data. And the exciting thing that's happened, in my opinion, at least in the last 4 to 5 years, is we're actually doing something with that data. It's not just sitting on a shelf. It's not a conversation you have over the winter. Looking back historically at what happened, now it's turning into something that we're starting able to actually make, you know, good management decisions about. And to me, that's the excitement of what's to come, is that if we can turn some of those, we can turn this information into predictors or something that's going to help us make better decisions. That's what's exciting about where we're going now.
All right, so that's a little bit about each of your farming operations, kind of your impressions of how technology's changed ag in the past. Let's drill down a little bit further. Let's talk about your each individual operations here. Talk about, and Matt, we'll start with you, talk a little bit about how you've implemented some technology onto your farm that you're utilizing. And it could be several options that you guys have really looked into and are really utilizing.
Well, when we started to implement precision ag on our farm, it was an efficiency type of thing. If you ask any grower, the quickest way to your heart is a straight line in a field, right? So, I mean, that's how we could say the guy that doesn't know what he's doing, he's got a little wiggle. My grandpa would tell you can fit more corn in a crooked row than you can a straight one. But the idea that we adapted was just efficiency. So the fatigue was less, you could go longer. And once you had the ability to start to be more efficient and equipment got smarter, then you started to do VRT technology and some of those things. We look at our farm as far as what is tag-along technology. So there's a lot of tag-along technology that somebody sells seed or chemical or something else, and they want you to buy something that's maybe it doesn't have the ability to stand by itself, but it's a tag-along type product versus something that actually changes the way we do things. And so, especially since the downturn in commodity prices, we've started looking more for farming for ROI versus raw yield. And so the things that we have used to do that are a lot of tissue sampling, all the VRT technology, but going back to what Pete said, making sure that the data that we collect is real. I can't wait to some of the people in the room actually take the grower or the person in the cab out of the equation. When there's an RFID tag on that bag of seed, that when it's pouring into the planter, we don't have to worry if we got it right or not. Because as it continues to move forward, I think that information being accurate is critical, and we'll continue then to go from there.
Ken?
Well, as we look at where we started with grid soil sampling and variable rate technology back in the late 80s and early 90s, today we've come a long way in changing the science of how we use that type of data. And I think that, you know, in this world, environmental world that we operate in, some of the biggest changes have come in the nitrogen and nitrogen modeling areas. Of course, we're all concerned about the environment and water quality. And with the platforms and modeling that we have out there, you know, we don't know whose model is right, but it has changed the way farmers think. The collection of data and looking at how it not only impacts yield, but also impacts the efficiencies of the operation is extremely important. And as we move forward and have more ability to integrate the economics totally with the precision ag data, as we're, you know, now moving into that arena, we'll have a better cost-benefit analysis along with an environmental analysis, because many companies that we do business with are looking at sustainability. They're looking at how do we do things. The EPA is looking over our shoulder. And so in today's world with technology, we're better able to document and to substantiate why we do certain management practices.
Pete.
So as far as technology goes, I've actually been an easy sale to most salesmen selling technology because I have this fear of missing out on anything. And so I think that that's kind of what's got us involved in technology. And when some of the new technology started coming out, whether it be auto steer or yield monitors or whatever, you know, I just had this fear that if we didn't jump on that train, that it was going to get too far away from us. And I think that there was something to that, because that's kind of what technology has. If you didn't get involved in an early time, it's kind of hard to get caught back up. And so that's kind of what got us originally involved into it, is just this fear of missing out on what the next greatest thing was going to be. And so we kind of did that fear of missing out thing for a while. And now we've kind of gone more into, you know, what problems is it solving? And really being specific about, is this technology solving a certain problem that we currently have? What is it? And then getting into whatever that technology is and making sure that it does have a economic return for us.
So almost here a two-part question, but what I'm hearing is really it's efficiency. It is more data that you've got to deal with, but it's also, of course, yield. What else? Any other motivation or impact on your operation in terms like that besides efficiency, yield, and just having more data?
Well, some of the other things that have come along with this is using the data and technology to better determine when is an appropriate time to be in the field. Also, you know, the weather data, as you look at weather and trying to plan today's activities or manage fleet activities, as you're trying to, as Matt says, they farm in five counties, you know, decide where you should be planting or harvesting. There's many other efficiencies that can be acquired through having the data, is just knowing how to utilize them. And there are platforms out there that are helping us to make those decisions, that have those algorithms that can help determine, you know, what is the soil moisture and how long does it take after a rainfall based on these soils to dry out to go to the field. Or in the case today, as we're looking at some of the new traits and, for instance, dicamba, and how will we treat that when we're spraying? It's more and more important that we have the data on wind and moisture and those sort of things so that we can properly follow the proper management of using some of these new technologies that we have available to us.
I think it's also about trying to find the percent win. So we can have the best plan. We probably all have a crop plan pretty close right now of what we're gonna do this year. And if everything is right and I raise my APH, which is my proven yield, or above it, I'm usually gonna be okay. But what happens if I'm in that regional spot of a drought or too much rain, and it's not vast enough that the market's gonna compensate with price, but I've got a lot less yields to deal with. And if I'm already working with a margin that's 10, 12% or less, and all of a sudden that price doesn't adjust because I have a localized event, I'm in a situation where I'm upside down. And so one of the things that we're starting to use information with is to build a base and then use predictive analytics to say, how am I doing? Because I can come back and add to that. Maybe I got a rain on the 4th of July and now my potential is 20% more. If I have a tool that allows me to say, hey, you need more in, I can put that on. And I can do that because I see the reward is there, versus all put that all up front and hope and cross my fingers that I get that rain on July 4th. And so some of that predictive analysis that we're having the opportunity to work with is really changing the way that we look at not necessarily just throwing a plan out there and hoping, but actually putting a base out there and adding to that. Our friends in the South and our friends in the North with sugar beets and some of those other crops, they'll abandon a crop. I have never seen a crop in Central Illinois somebody pull the plug on because it was going to be a losing proposition. We will continue to fight it and continue to fight it. even at our own financial detriment.
Well, how about this? And Pete, we'll start with you. Because you mentioned that you wanted to be an early adapter. You were easy for the salesman. But what else was your motivation? Why be the guinea pig for some of these products that are out there? Why did you want to be the first?
I'm kind of asking myself those questions right now. You know. I guess I can tackle that a couple different ways. I think that we really wanted to, I mean, our ultimate goal was to make money in this business, right? So we wanted to find what were those things that were going to get us there. So we were trying to find technologies that were ultimately going to make us more bushels or more money. And quite frankly, every salesman I talked to, their product was going to gain me 10 bushels or make me hundreds of thousands of dollars more. So I bought into those things. And I say that, you know, somewhat tongue in cheek, but I mean, it seems like every product that was brought to the market had was bringing some sort of value that we thought was something that we could put on our farm. So I think that was probably why we chased after all those things in early time.
What about costs? So I'm not asking you specific costs on anything you guys have done, but how big a factor was the cost of this technology? Did it weigh on you of, you know, hey, that right now that's just too much, I'm not going to do it? Or at the end, as Pete talked about, where everybody's in it, we've got to make a profit here in each year. How much did the cost of some of this weigh into your decision making?
Yeah, it seems like whenever technology was first coming out, in my opinion, in our operation, we were betting on the come. So we were betting that the whatever team we joined with was going to take us clear to the finish line. And then I think our thought process on that has kind of evolved over time. Now we only take on technologies that are going to have return in year one. Technology changes so fast right now that if you're hitching on to a company that's not giving you immediate returns, we have to find somewhere else to go. And so our focus has been on, you know, we're only taking on those technologies that solve the problem immediately and give us an immediate impact, and not betting on a company to be the one that we're going to be with 5-10 years down the road.
You know, I think when we evaluate a lot of technology, we can't, I kind of call it the iPhone syndrome. How many people, raise your hand if you got an iPhone 7? Everybody raise your hand in the room. Tell me what it does different than the iPhone 6. And the idea of that, if I told you that to upgrade those from a 6 to a 7 cost you $60,000, would you have done it? And that's one of the things that we see that happens a lot in the technology is we're seeing small incremental improvements on some things that, quite honestly, when they were introduced, maybe be disruptive technology. Some of the stuff on the planters or yield monitors or some of those things. But then they're tweaking it. And so I think you have two camps, the camps that are going to buy whatever's new because they need to do that. And then I think you have the camp that kind of learned from always buying the stuff that was first, right? And we were in that same camp to say, now, what's it going to do for me? And I actually think that the ultimate win is going to be kind of a spoken hub that I'm going to have a core idea or somebody that can get me in pretty close, but then they're going to work with other companies to fill in their weak spots. The question is will all these companies decide to work together, or do they have to stay in their own silo?
I think one of the things is Matt and Pete were discussing here is working with companies that will listen to what our needs are. And that is all important because to stay in the long term in the technology business, you basically have to satisfy what our needs are and not what you think our needs are. It's just like software developers that develop programs and then the user has no defined benefit from using it. And I think that as we have looked at platforms and worked with different platforms, we have stayed with the ones that basically have created programs and analytics that will fit our needs in the field, and that's all important for us in the agriculture arena.
So the three of you, again, have been out there and out front maybe on some of this technology. Talk about the learning curve, both for you individually to utilize it on your farming operation, but let's not forget the other people that help you with the farming operation, whether that be an uncle, a dad, a brother, whomever it may be. Talk a little bit about that, of the learning curve of getting the operation to fully adapt to the technology that you're using. Matt, why don't we start with you?
So when you have multiple individuals and multiple machines, one of the things that you're going to find out in a farming operation is your priority to technology is a lot different than anybody else in that cab. So whoever's in charge of the technology on the farm, it's very important to them. For everybody else, it's maybe a nuisance. So we've worked pretty hard on trying to help educate why this is important, that it's not just corn, or it's just not 112-day corn, but it's 112-day corn of X variety, because as we're trying to look at soil types or response to fungicide, nitrogen, some of those things, those little differences in phenotypes are going to tell us a lot. What's cool about agriculture is, for the most of the folks that are rooted in agriculture, they're going to take the time, if they're involved in a new technology, to help you understand. That's the cool thing about ag. Everybody cares, and they're going to help you, and they're going to listen. And so the adoption as far as our own operation, it's not really that big a deal if you have somebody that cares. If you've got somebody that's peddling it, it's a different story. That's where I'm so looking forward to the day that I don't have to input anything. And so the more information that somebody asks me to input at a screen, that's an opportunity for error. And when you're doing all the analysis in maybe October, November, December, after the year, you can't remember if that guy actually remembered to put that test strip in. Or was it 200 pounds of nitrogen that he put on, or 225 on the confidence strip or block? And those are really big deals when you start to analyze that. And for our operation, it continues to be a challenge.
Ken, how about you?
Well, myself, I mean, when we started in all this business back in the early 90s, there weren't any books written. We wrote them as we go. So most of what I've learned has just been seat of the pants and, you know, just natural knowledge of being around computers and those sort of things, and it works on the farm too. But with people who work with you in your operation, it takes a learning process to explain the importance, as Matt said, of documentation, the importance of being able to run put the right field in, to set your guidance lines up and use the right guidance lines. And so patience is the key watchword. I think that we've all learned to be more patient with our help and to teach them why it's important to us. It may not be important to them, but the collection of the data is important in the total economics of the operation. And so therefore, we need to impress upon our fellow employees or even family of why the necessity of keeping track of all the data. The other thing is the ease of use, and that's one thing that in developing products, as Matt said, you know, the more data we have to enter, the harder it is to make sure that it's correct. And so with the new telematics, now it's made it a lot easier, but we need to continue on that track as new products are developed for the future.
Pete?
Yeah, so when I think about this, I think about on my desktop computer right now that I have an icon for a accounting software, one for a management software, one for something that analyzes the GPS data we have. I could probably list, you know, maybe 10 different things there on my desktop that are programs to go into that we use to make management decisions in our operation. And I think about that's not that hard for me to manage, but my employees or people that work with this, I mean, that's a lot of different places to go to for sometimes the same information. One of the frustrations we have in our operation is that, you know, these different icons on my desktop won't play with each other, so they don't talk to each other. It's as Steve Pizdick would say there's a lot of friction in the data working together, and we need frictionless data, right? I mean, we need something that happens in our management software to move over to our accounting software, that moves on to over to our mapping software. We need these things to all play nice together. And so we're asking our employees to learn three different systems to be able to gather the data we need. It's a big frustration for us. And as we look at new technologies, I mean, we're looking for those that fit all those needs in one. And we're not asking for one company to come up with something that fits all those needs, but we're asking for one company to be able to play nicely with all the other companies so that we can have access to all that data, or those employees can see consistency whenever they are inputting things into our operations.
So Pete, let's build on that a second. And Ken mentioned this early that a few minutes ago about that he wants to utilize technology where people are willing to work with him and find out what he needs and talk with him first. Has that been your experience, Matt and Pete, that you have had these companies that are coming to you with the technology that say, we want to partner with you. We don't want to just say, here it is, I'm sure it'll fit what you're doing. Let us know if you have any problems. Have you had the experience where it has gone well, the discussions, and they really want to learn how it's impacting you, they want to learn how they can customize it, et cetera? Has that been you guys' experience as well? Because Ken talked about he does a lot of some research on some of his stuff, and that's critical with research, being able to customize some things. So Matt, Pete, is that your experience?
So much in ag is relationships, and that's what I think a lot of the companies that don't have roots in ag struggle with, because they can say, I have a superior product, but they don't build the relationship to try to help understand the need and then how to solve a problem. I think the companies that have vested interest in ag, that are long-term players, whether they might only be 6 months old, are willing to work. The companies, and that's the one thing when you saw the venture capital slide, there's a lot of companies that are motivated by a quarterly statement. And you can tell those companies are a lot of times on their farm because it's, hey, let's do this today. How about let's see where this is going to go. You know, and you start talking about how it's going to integrate, or I've got a concern. Yeah, let's get this done today. And so I'm all about working with folks with relationships. I think Chris at Agribull said it, the folks that actually get it and want to work with folks, those guys are going to be around, and I think that's what we're going to see in this next 18 months, the shift of the people that are really, truly in ag and believe in it, and the folks that have just got a good idea looking for a quick buck.
Well, I just like that, we've been involved in several of these programs and in helping these companies come up with products that hopefully will work. At the risk of being too cynical here, I will say though that oftentimes we're building these companies' programs at a cost, and you know, we're very transparent, we're very open about how we operate, and we tell them exactly, you know, hey, these are the things that aren't working for us. And oftentimes you know you're helping these companies build programs that are better, but we're paying for that. I mean, there's a for every pilot program we've done, it seems like there is a cost associated with it. And so we're helping build these programs, and at the end of the year, you get a bill for helping build those programs. And I think that there is some frustration on my end with that, and maybe some hesitation as we move forward to helping companies build programs that are ultimately going to charge us $4 more an acre, or find some type of charge associated with that for a program that wouldn't be there without our help. And you know, I'm not saying that in a sense of we're making these programs, but we're helping build them. We're finding the holes in them, and we're wanting to help make them better. And a lot of times, these programs are sold to us, or technologies, I should say, are sold to us with the expectation that they're complete programs or complete technologies. And oftentimes, we get involved in them. Sign on board with them, get involved with them, and you find that it's a work in progress. We're not to the point that we gave you a demonstration on, but we will be, you know, 6 months down the road. And so we work 6 months down the road helping them fix these problems, and then before you know it, it's renewal time. and they're kicking the can in their 6 months. And once again, I'm not trying to turn this into a negative conversation, but I think those are things that people in the industry need to be aware of too, that, you know, we want to help make these better, but sometimes it's at our expense to do that.
Matt and Ken, maybe you two can expand on what, Pete, what are your thoughts on that?
Well, part of the problem is that there's some extremely smart people who reside in California that create software that can be very beneficial to agriculture, but they don't really understand agriculture and how we think, because farmers think on a different level in a different manner than a software developer. Also, the needs of the farmer sometimes are much different than the perceived needs that the platform industry or developers of products think we need. And so, you know, from that perspective, we do welcome working with companies that don't understand agriculture, but we also want them to understand that there is a value in our time in helping them to understand what it is that farmers need and how they can develop their product to be able to sell commercially to fit the ag world.
Many of the companies that are here today or the investors that would be in this room would understand the value of IP and what that would mean to the worth of that company, but also how it is used and compensated for if it is used. And at some point in time, a grower's IP, which might not be some algorithm that we base or that we came up with on our farm, but 26 years of data that's spatially relevant by maybe 2.5 acre grid will have value. And I think that we're gonna start to see a day that probably in the next 10 years, if we had that, I would look forward to see that there would be a revenue stream for the data that we're producing. I think that's gonna be one of the next big litmus tests. So are you confident enough in your program that you're willing to pay me to use it? And if you are, and I get all the side benefits, now we're on to something. But I think a lot of the technology in that the last 3 to 4 years, especially some of this tag-along technology, has been built to try to protect an entity that's other than tech. It might be a seed or a chemical sale. And when that has happened, the valuable nature of that process or whatever that technology should have been was compromised as long as we got the seed or chemical sale. And so I look forward to a day that somebody believes enough in their technology that is willing to pay me to use it. And I see a value in that, that it's, I'll be the first one to sign up, because especially if there's value there that helps our operation be more profitable or efficient.
In the technology that you guys have adopted in your individual operations, give me a percentage of which has been sort of on the computer side, the data versus the biological chemical side, chemistry side of things. You know, Ken mentioned the managing your nutrients better. I put that a little more on the biological, the chemistry side, but obviously the yield monitor and the combines, the technology side. Give me a breakdown of some of the technology you've adopted. Give me a percentage. Which falls into each side of the category? And have we reached a peak on either side of those?
You're Pete? Asking a hard question.
I started that in.
Yeah.
And the reason I say that is you know, we have new traits in genetics, and I'm an adopter. You know, when something new comes to the marketplace, I'm going to be the first to use it. Same way, whether it's software, I guess I'm one of those guilty, as Matt said, you know, if a new iPhone comes out, usually I have to get one just because it's new and different. But the same way, you know, as we've had advancements in technology, and part of the problem is because the cost to keep up is horrendous. I mean, if you get behind by 3 to 5 years in the change in technology today on the farm, it can be $50,000 to $100,000 to get caught back up again, just because things are changing that fast today. Not that that's bad, but for those who are entering that are not the early adopters and not the the people that are in the mid-range that are just getting into this technology, it's the cost hurdle is where the problem is today.
And I think, not to dodge the question, I think they're all important, but I think it all stems back to weather. So I can make the right decision. Maybe it's a micronutrient that a sensor told me to put on because that was the right thing to do that time, and then it not rain for 6 weeks, and I have zero outcome. I might have been able to see a physical response to that plant or that crop in the next 2 weeks, but how I get paid or how I get evaluated, ROI or bushels in the tank, it might not have been there at all. So I think that's one of the reasons you're seeing this weather thing being such an important predictor. I've heard a lot of times that, you know, corn has a potential of 600 bushel. I think Dr. Belo talks about that all the time. And everything we do takes away from those things. And all we're really doing is trying to protect that potential. I mean, we're not building yield. We're just trying to protect the yield that's already there from everything else that we can control. And so we can try to control everything until we can start controlling weather, I don't know if that's happening or not. Maybe we'll build a biodome over our farm. But until that happens, I really think we're trying to minimize the loss or minimize the impact on that potential crop.
So, Pete, Matt said control the weather. Let's turn your question to how are we going to control the weather? How are we going to control the weather, Pete? Have you got that answer of how we're going to?
That might be easier than your last question, actually. So I think about in terms of like seed companies. You know, every year we wanted. And I'm changing this from weather to seed company. I'm already shifting things here. So you think about seed companies, and we wanted new technologies in seed companies as farmers. We said, bring us new stuff. And so they brought us new stuff. And so every year they came out with a new variety or a new hybrid or something like that. And now we're kind of like, well, when does this hybrid respond to nitrogen? Or when does it respond to this? And the people at the seed company are like, I don't know. You just told us to have new hybrids come out, you know? And I'm kind of oversimplifying the situation. But we have asked these people to give us technology, new stuff all the time, new. We got to have the newest stuff. And then we turn around and we say, well, we want to know more about it. And you know, so maybe in terms of us being able to do these predictors, or sensors or predictors or whatever the next thing is going to be, we don't have the people in place to answer those questions right now or don't know the answers to it. And so it kind of just comes back to we're reporting the weather because we don't have the stuff in place to tell you what's going to happen beyond 48 hours.
So do you see that as a challenge within agriculture, that we're going to have good quality people moving forward to interpret, to help you interpret the data that you are collecting on all this? Do you think that's a challenge moving forward, that it's going to be difficult for these companies that are creating these to find people that not only create it, but then go out and help you interpret it and apply it? We've talked about that, or several of you have touched on that, applying what we learned. Do you think that's going to be a challenge for the industry as we move forward?
You know, as an advocate of ag, I hope not. If you look, I've seen anywhere from 50 to 70% of the land is going to change hands in the next 10 years, whether that would be a generational thing, somebody dying or whatever else. And if you look at the amount of young folks that are gonna come back for opportunity, if we have access to capital, or if you don't wanna be on the production side, you just wanna be a scientist and engineer, the opportunity, somebody would have to make a really, really strong argument to me to say that there would be more opportunity than any other industry than agriculture. Because if you don't think ag's important, skip the next five or six meals and tell me how you feel. And that's the thing that I would hope that those folks would come back to do that. I think we, the three of us and our industry, needs to become a better promoter of not only the opportunity that's there, but the fact that we are trying to be really good stewards and continuing to produce more with less into a country that, to be honest, we pretty much take our next meal for granted. And so I would hope that we would not have a hard time finding folks, I hope the universities are full.
I think one of the other things is we forward look, predictive analytics is really going to be the name of the game as we move forward, whether it's in seed genetics and trying to predict what's the next best new hybrid, whether it's in nitrogen management, whether it's in weather management, soil moisture. I mean, there's so many things that predictive analytics can help us in our day-to-day operations that I think that those in college that are looking for a direction, that that's an area that we really need more help in.
Well, Pete, I'm going to start with you on this one. What's next? What's on the horizon out there that piques your interest, Pete? What's something you've been reading about or hearing about, or even you haven't heard anything about, you just wish you had, that you'd like to try to utilize on your farm?
So for me, I think it's a way that we can pull what we have together and find a way to use it better. And I'm not going to act like I know what the next best thing is out there, but if we could just utilize the technologies that we have in a simple way, if we could take the best part of each company and be able to put it together into a system that played well together. So I had one icon on my iPhone that I had to push, and I could find out how putting nitrogen on after a rain would affect my ROI and how many bushels I would have left to sell after that. You know, something, and that, you know, that's probably a poor example, but being able to think about how each move I make impacts my entire operation, and being able to easily look at that and make better decisions off of it.
Matt?
Yeah, building on what Pete is saying, benchmarking is my hot button. Being able to capture all that information, but just like Pete said, understanding how that next move is going to affect my operation. And I don't need a software or a hardware platform to tell me exactly what to do, but I would love to get a predictive, you know, a probability. Hey, we got an 85% chance that this is going to be a fungicide application that's going to have positive ROI. But I really look forward to, I think in the next 10 years, we're going to be able to define precision agriculture back into decision agriculture. And so it'll be predict, there'll be some sort of software that'll be predicting, there'll be some sort of a sensor package, whether it's, you know, in the field, in a satellite, on a drone, that will confirm that prediction. And then I will be able to make an educated guess, because it's still a guess, right? Because I can't take weather out of it, but I can make an educated guess of what I need to do next. And I look forward to somebody in this room figuring that out in the next 10 years.
I guess to answer that question, in forward looking, if I could just take the best and most useful parts of each company that is in, you know, available today with platforms, and put it together to, as Matt and Pete both have said, to be more, make our operation more useful with just one button to push, that would be what I see the future being. I think that that's the biggest frustration we have today of why, you know, people ask, well, why do you have so many different platforms that you're working with? Well, because there is no best one-size-fits-all platform. There are many good features in many different programs, but nobody has put the one platform together that does everything.
Well, let's kind of wrap this up. And in any closing thoughts, Matt, on what we've talked about or today of again, what are you looking forward to or anything else you want to add here before we wrap up for lunch? Because we are the panel that keeps everybody out here from eating lunch.
Well, I think it's important to remember that I used to always use this analogy because I was a Cardinal fan, but saying like farmers are kind of like eternal Cub fans, but Cubs actually proved me wrong on this, right? There's always next year. But the idea that no matter what, whether it makes financial sense, we hope it makes financial sense, but it's something in a grower's DNA that no matter what happens, they're going to try it again next year, and their optimism about that next crop is not going to be hindered. So there's responsibility with that. And so the idea that knowing that the group that you're going to talk to is an eternal optimist that is going to look for that next best thing that's not only going to provide for their family, their way of life, but also there's usually a deeper rooted provide for a much larger nation. We need to remember that that is a very holy spot for the American grower. And I think in the last 3 to 5 years, it's been preyed upon quite heavily. And so all I would ask is that, back to Pete's point, if you've got new technology, we're gonna continue to evolve and we're gonna continue to try to get better. And we're gonna use something that, you know, we're not gonna build that faster horse, we're gonna build the automobile. You guys are gonna do that in the room, but be mindful of that holy optimism that the grower has. And that's an asset that you can work with, but not prey upon.
Ken?
And I think one other thing you have to remember, here in Central Illinois, we're only able to grow one crop a year. And so we only get one opportunity to get it right. So it's extremely important that whatever management decisions that we make from the analysis of our data, that we do get it right. But as Matt says, there is always optimism that next year will be better, even if this year didn't turn out quite like we thought it would be. We're always forward thinkers, and we'll do it again next year just because that's the DNA in farmers.
And Pete?
I really have nothing more to add other than the fact that it's a great time to be a part of agriculture. And I said that 10 years ago, and I thought, man, this is awesome. You know, and we're at it again, and I'm just as excited about it now as what I was then. So, you know, we're doing great things. It's scary to be part of, not everybody thinks like us, and that's kind of hard for me to get through my head sometimes. And so we have to be patient and compassionate with people that maybe have different views we have and think that, you know, in terms of our job is to educate those people because we are the experts in food, right? I mean, so we're the experts in what we're doing. And so if we stay passionate, we stay optimistic, and we continue to do the right things, I mean, there's a bright future for ag.
Well, thanks, guys, for helping us out today. Appreciate all your input. Matt, Ken, Pete, thanks for participating.